Can you try one more?
It don't mean a thing if it ain't a nothing.
If it ain't a
it makes no difference if it's sweet or hot. Just give that rhythm everything you've got. Ra-da-da-da, don't do ra-da-da-da. Ra-da-da-da-da-da. Do-wa-do-wa, do-wa, 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 sha-ba-da-ba-da.
Can we get some water? Chief Chef Meredith, can we get some water up this way? Ladies and gentlemen, hey, here he is. Ladies and gentlemen, who'd like to welcome? Have a seat, Kevin. It is your part. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to welcome you to this community and family celebration honoring a local hero, Captain Eldridge Meredith. He's been on the bay for over 80 years, and you'll hear more about his story as the evening goes on. But at this time, I'd like to turn to the Honorable James J. Moran, Queen Anne County Board of Commissioners, to offer you greetings.
Captain Meredith, it is a true honor to be here, paying homage to your service to the county and to the Chesapeake Bay. I, for one, it's one of the reasons I moved here, is for the water, and I get on it as much as I can because that's where I'm happy. Because politics sometimes can get a little dicey. But I want to thank everybody for coming today. I want to thank the Lieutenant Governor, Secretary Belton, Jeannie Hadaway. Love. So, you know, with Queen Anne's County, we have so many treasures that we never know that are underneath our own noses, and it's nice that we can acknowledge Captain Meredith, now Admiral, so I'll make sure that our Chief of Police, the Honorable Mr. Hoffman, knows that you outrank him from here on out, so you should not have any problems. So thank you all for coming, and let's move the program forward.
Thank you. We did get the word. I think it's going to be in your meeting in March that Meredith's family will be coming to the county council to get further recognized. And we do have Queen Anne's TV here that's broadcasting, and it will be broadcast to schools, colleges, and universities throughout the Mid-Atlantic region. And thank you and your good offices. At this time, we're going to have a sermonic invocation again by Karen Somerville and Sambakin, a sermonic invocation.
I love you, Lord, and I live. I love you, Lord, and I live my life.
Us the Maryland Secretary of Natural Resources, Secretary Mark Belton. We weren't sure what's your schedule, but can you just come up and represent your agency at this time, sir?
Absolutely. Captain, I'm really excited to be here this evening.
I am surprised.
Well, wait till later. You're even more surprised. A lot of people in the room don't know it, but some people do. I used to be in the Navy, and I retired at the rank of Admiral. So tonight, the Lieutenant Governor is here, and a little bit later on, we're going to join you to the club. But I just want to point out that for Governor Hogan and this administration, he really represents and is out there looking out for the working man, and the watermen are particularly close to his heart. And you represent the watermen better than anybody I can think of. 80 years on the Chesapeake Bay. My goodness, sir. Congratulations. My pleasure to be here tonight to help honor you.
And that was Secretary Mark Belton, Maryland Department of Natural Resources, and a friend of ours. Mark Castelli is an artist and a waterman on the Chesapeake Bay from Chestertown. Mark, you have a presentation.
Vince called me a while ago, asked me if I would do a
Captain,
painting.
Can you come around?
Captain,
can you come around?
Captain Eldridge and his son Tyro. I don't normally do portraits because you'll have to excuse my French.
Here they come on this side.
I didn't paint a boat, oyster, crab, fish, weather, but this one worked out rather nicely, so. Sir?
Lisa, can you lift it up higher, Mark?
I tell you what, not let me take
it.
Admiral, can you step in just a little bit?
Oh, come on now. I hate being on the other side of the camera. I hope you do too.
All right then. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
did that too, because I normally go fishing with them.
And one of the things with Mark, he came down and spent the day with us. He took the pictures. He went back to his studio, and he did an original that's going to travel as a part of our exhibit as it goes around the Mid-Atlantic region. And then he did a artist proof, one for Dr. Mel Rapelier from the Chestertown area, who is a patron of arts and works with the Sultana Education Project. The other goes to Captain Meredith, Tyrone, and then, so thank you for your generosity and your support. At this time, we have another waterman, Captain Harry Davidson, that's going to do a tribute.
This song is about a lifetime waterman from Kent Island, John Peak, and he was a color. He was a color on a, the color is probably the most important man on the boat, because after these guys work, 10 hours, if the DNR is there waiting for them to make them throw the oysters overboard. So the color is really the most important man on the boat. John Pete, he called on, sorry to put my foot in the chair.
Yes, sir, that's fine.
John Pete called for Sam White Larry and his son Moses Larry all their life. And I went down to Thompson Creek Landing more than once, and when they come in, they had, this was back in the 40s and the early 50s, they had anywhere from 40 to close to 100 bushels. And times have changed, you know. But it's called a Long John, the oyster calling man. They were scraping deep using long time as the oysters were coming strong. Sam and his son would recommend, Johnny called them clean. The ice was making on the oyster calls and the weather was downright mean. They may get him riled up, but never get him piled up on John. The oyster calling man. Snow fell heavy on his long brimmed cap, and his hands he moved like a man with a cause. When it comes to the final tally, won't be an oyster lost long time. The oyster calling man. He was 7 foot tall and 5 feet, worked all his life on the chest. Nose edges like the back of his hand, Long John, the oyster calling man. The cigarette dropped from his frozen lips and his hands they rolled about. This spring of morn and the spring of the straw, Long John will call him by his Long John. Oyster calling man. He was 7 foot tall and his bare feet worked all the life on the chest of me. Nose the edges like the back of his hand on God. Oyster calling man.
NARS is a national organization that works with families, in particular children and young adults around the country. And annually, the organization picks trailblazers, pioneers, those who find a new pathway to keep people and communities vibrant. So, Captain, you were selected this year to be the organization's Trailblazer of the Year. on behalf of its board of directors and its national membership of about 15,000 individuals to make this presentation to you, naming you today as NARSA's Trailblazer of the Year. And I want you to know that throughout the year, at quarterly events around the country, a notation of this award is made, and we make an effort to empower others with what you have contributed to keeping Maryland afloat on the Chesapeake Bay. Thank you very, very much.
It's not your turn to speak yet, Cap. Hang in there. Captain Warren Butler, we talked with, work your way up, Captain, and don't come through the DMZ zone. Go this way or something. I can't afford to get one more wire bumped. But Captain Warren Butler started around the same time or a week after, and those guys have been working on the waters for 70 and 80 years, and he's also an innovator, served on the Queen Anne's County Board of Education, also served our country with distinction, and we've asked him to represent and acknowledge the other black captains of the Chesapeake. Captain Butler, thank you, my friend.
Good evening, folks.
Good evening.
When I first observed Captain Meredith taking passengers out fishing in 1948 after coming home from the U.S. Navy, many people were stopping at Kent Island, going to and fro from to Delaware and Cape May, New Jersey. Captain Eldridge had a vast knowledge of the Chesapeake Bay, having been coming from a past generation of watermen and fishermen, as his dad, Mr. Earl, his Uncle Herman, his Uncle Oliver Lynch and Jack Lynch, Mr. Will Lynch, and his grandfather, Mr. Richard Meredith. This upper part of the Chesapeake Bay was alive with an abundance of fish, crabs, and oysters. Captain Meredith was a good oyster catcher as well as a fisherman. With his two cousins, Maurice and Melvin, I remember seeing him come ashore one day with 100 bushels of oysters, wow, caught with hand tongs and sold to Harris's Crab House. The Sparrows Point workers, after meeting Captain Meredith, really came to the eastern shore and Kent Island to catch fish. Hundreds of fishermen from Baltimore and area, and the opening of, after the opening of the Chesapeake Bay Bridge industry to the oyster fishing business and the younger black captains. Captain Meredith shared his intelligence and spirit and inspiration to many and everyone who asked for it and needed it. One night he rescued Captain Tommy Ewing at midnight. We were coming in from fishing and Captain Ewing's boat hit a stationary buoy and sank. Captain Meredith maneuvered his boat around there and saved all those people on the boat. Captain Meredith did lots of night fishing. Every captain has a sidekick, and that many that would call a nobody, but one that is liked by everybody. Captain Meredith's sidekick was Squeaky and Willie Handy. Passengers from all walks of life. Many clergy and men were aboard on any given day, and Captain Meredith would always tell them that with a minister aboard and everybody respected him while he was on board the boat. Our county commissioners and county government and how to, Captain Meredith knew how to talk to our county commissioners and our county government, and they approved the work we were doing and kept our public landings and things so we could park cars when people came over to use our fishing ground. Captain Meredith had his own dock, but he helped to keep the public docks straight so the rest of us could use them. Thanks to our county officials and county commissioners for keeping those piers, because we had nowhere to tie boats and park automobiles. And I'm going to say happy birthday to Captain Meredith, and may you have many, many more happy birthdays.
And could you ask the other black captains, would they please stand? All black captains. All black captains, stand or wave if you're already standing. Thank you, Captain Butler. At this time, I'm going to invite up our young filmmaker, Kristen Smooth. Where you at, Kristen? Come on up and get onto the wheels of steel, and I'll say more about you, but it's time to turn down the lights and cut up the music. Captain Murray. Blacks of the Chesapeake and African Americans have been an integral part of the maritime and seafood industry for over 400 years. Since the landing at Jamestown, Virginia, African Americans have been present on the bay, free and enslaved. Their stories, not known to many, tell the tale about how their lives were shaped by the Chesapeake Bay. There were individuals such as Frederick Douglass, who was born into slavery on Maryland's eastern shore. And he talked about how he stood on the banks of the Chesapeake Bay and watched tall, gallant ships, their massive sails looking like angel wings flapping to freedom. And he was held in bondage. And he said that this bay shall yet bear me to freedom. And that was a part of his story, where he dressed up as a seaman and boarded a train in Baltimore. And from Baltimore, he crossed the Susquehanna River at the head of the bay and then on to Philadelphia and New York. So the bay did play a role in his freedom. And Harriet Tubman talked about her life on the Chesapeake Bay in Dorchester County. Harriet Tubman knew the waterways of the Chesapeake Bay, and on one occasion, she sent word for her family to hire a fishing boat in Cambridge and meet her at Botkin Point on the western shore of the Chesapeake Bay. So African Americans such as Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman used the bay as a part of their escape to freedom. But then there are other people on the Chesapeake Bay, maybe not as known as well as Frederick Douglass or Harriet Tubman, but their life story is just as significant. And one of the individuals that we're featuring is Captain Eldridge Meredith, a quintessential Chesapeake Bay waterman. Watermen are independent businessmen, and their commitment to one of America's most treasured natural resources earns them a measure of respect throughout the Mid-Atlantic region. African-American watermen have been harvesting and sailing the bay since first coming to its shores, but stories, particularly to their lives, are not well known. Bay watermen are resilient and adapt to challenges to their way of life, both socially, politically, environmentally, and economically. Captain Eldridge Meredith, at the sprightly age of 90,
represents a link to the past and a bridge to the future for the fabled Chesapeake Bay Waterman. He was born on February 23, 1926, and grew up in Chester, located on Kent Island, which sits on the eastern shore side of the Bay Bridge.
I'm 90 years old. I've been living on Kent Island. In fact, all my life up until I went into service. And my father and I bought a place down here. We moved here. So my father, he lived, he died at the age of 74. What he died from was pneumonia. He had caught pneumonia. Back in them time, and people didn't know too much about it. So, but he lived a good life.
He, along with his six brothers and sisters, attended Queen Anne's County Public Schools. After his public school education, he helped his father crabbing and fishing on the Chesapeake Bay.
I went 3 years in Kent Island High School. I was supposed to go 4 years, but my father took sick, and he was sick for a couple of years. And after he took sick, I had stopped and go to work, take care of the family, because it was pretty hard back in them days. You didn't make a whole lot of money back in the 50s. So anyway, I took a boat, went out on the water, and I was making quite a bit of money.
Captain Meredith has also honorably served his country. In 1942, he enlisted in the United States Navy, where he served until 1944.
I wanted to go in the Army. I didn't want the Navy. So after I got in, take the tests and everything, they said, we want you in the Navy. So I said, well, all right with me. I said, I've been on the water. I know, you know, a lot about the water. So anyway, so after I got in there for 6 months, they said, we're going to send you to London, Connecticut, and train you. I said, for what? He said, we're going to put you on a sub. I said, no, you ain't put me on the sub. I said, there's enough beer on top of the water, and I know I'm not going to eat the water. So he said, well, we need someone like you. We need you. I said, you better find somebody else, but I'm not going. So anyway, they decided to let me do what I wanted to do. So I said, stay in the Navy. I wasn't going on the sub. So anyway, my mother and father had to sign anyway. Going to sub, and it I don't know how many papers that had signed this, signed that, in case something did happen. They put you through a lot of tests. Anyway, I got in the Navy and I stayed in almost 3 years, and I went everywhere in the United States, but never went overseas. But it was nice. It was a lot of experience. And I think every boy that's coming up today should get some service. If you don't go to college, go in some part of the service. Navy, Coast Guard, Army, something. Because it's an experience you learn about.
In 1950, Captain Meredith married Margaret Ann.
I went to the theater one night, so on the way back, after we got home, she said, wait, don't leave right away, I'm gonna talk to you. She said, look, are we gonna get married, or what you gonna do? It has been 2 years. If you're not gonna marry me, don't come to me. See me in the movie. Yeah, he got the life next day.
And from this union, they had six children. Rita, Vera, Eldridge Jr., Tyrone, Tyra, and Sheila.
And I'm a fourth generation waterman that worked the Chesapeake Bay and live on Kent Island. And I started out as a mate during the summer on my father's boat, as a mate cleaning the boat and catching fish and selling the fish to the customers. And he let me occasionally operate the boat coming in when I was 6-7 years old. And then when I was like 12 or 13, I started crabbing, was trot lining on my own little boat, catching crabs during the summer when the school was out. And I worked every summer, and turned 16, I saved enough money to buy a brand new car by crabbing on it. And then I learned how to catch oysters in what they call hand tonguing. I caught oysters days I didn't go to school. Then when I finished school, I worked with my father's mate on his charter boat. And I went to college and I worked as a sales rep for MetLife for about 5 to 10 years. And then I left and went back to the water business, and I started as a, worked as a mate on my father's boat until I bought my own boat and started running charters.
Still, he couldn't get away from the water. He was still be on the water. So he was still with me, and he works with me. He has a boat and I have the boat, so we're still on the water. I'm glad someone, you know, followed in my footsteps, because after I didn't think nobody else was going to bother with it.
In response to his rapidly expanding business, Captain Meredith purchased the Island Queen in 1966. This vessel became the biggest of the head boats on Kent Island.
I bought the boat from Boston, and it took me about 5 days to bring it home. But the reason I bought this boat, because the boat that I had, it was 45 feet. It was licensed for 38 passions, and it was kind of getting small, so I looked for a larger boat. And this, the wheel that came off this boat, it was 65 feet long, 18 feet wide, licensed for 110 passions. And I kept it for 16 years, had plenty of experience coming down the bay, because we always pull in different harbors when it came at night, and we would leave around 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning on the way home. So one particular morning, we was out in leaving Connecticut, and we saw this thing in front of us, and it was going through the water. It's something that's going right through the water, and come find out it was a submarine right in front of us. He knew that I wasn't going to get too close. He wasn't going to get too close to me. So we made out all right. So we headed right on down until we hit New York. It came on in New York. We stayed overnight. Then we went down to Cape May, New Jersey. From Cape May, we spent the night in Cape May. Next morning, we left at 5. Came on up to Delaware Bay, to the canal, on over in the Chesapeake. When I saw that Chesapeake Bay Bridge, I said, it's home now.
Prior to the building of the first Bay Bridge, they would also haul scrap iron and metal to Baltimore in their boats to make money. He also remembers when there were approximately 12 oyster packing houses on Kent Narrows alone, employing hundreds of seafood workers.
And after oysters got so scarce, a lot of packing houses went out of business. So a lot of the guys sold the property and they didn't build up down the Kent Narrows. They got hotels, they got restaurants, and so forth. So it's packing houses, I think we have one Parrish's crab house, and he has an oyster house. United Shellfish, they have one. They should have oysters. claims. During the time when I was coming along, when you had all them packing houses down there, it was quite a few people living down there. And money, they made good money. It was not right nice, but like everything else, I guess it don't last only so long.
You meet a lot of different people by going out on the boat. And by being a waterman's daughter, it's his livelihood. It's something he loves to do. And it's something that I also like to do. We always have a lot of people that we meet by going out on the boat. I've met someone that was a freedom rider while I was out fishing on the boat helping my dad. I also met a man that was in the Army, and he was one of the original Tuskegee Airmen. So I've met a lot of exciting and different people on the boat.
Try to people to, when they come aboard, to make them feel like they're home and make sure they have everything they need when they're on a fishing trip, and to get them to come back.
Captain Meredith does his part in preserving the bay. He remembers when the bay was clear and you could see the bottom. When you caught oysters, you returned the shells to the bay to help more grow. He has implemented a recycling program in which 95% of all trash on his charter boats are recycled. He loves the water and will continue to do his part to make it safe and enjoyable. Captain Meredith has been recognized by numerous organizations for his contributions to preserving the cultural and natural diversity of the Chesapeake Bay.
I love Chesapeake Bay. Made money, a lot of money out of the bay. Horsing, crabbing, clamming, fishing. I mean, the bay took care of a lot of people. Yeah, they made money off the bay, a nice living on the Chesapeake Bay. But only thing that I could about the bay, storm come up fast. When you see a little dark cloud or something and hear that thunder, you better get off the bay. That was my plan. I'll be the first one leave. And brought up the bay. You stay on that water when you hear that thunder and lightning coming, you get off there. But as far as everything else, it was nice. I enjoyed working on the bay. Getting up in the morning, getting the fresh air. It was really nice. I liked it.
We'd like to thank the Maryland Governor, Larry Hogan, and Lieutenant Governor Gord Rutherford. We reached out to them and suggested they designate Captain Meredith an Admiral and Ambassador of the Chesapeake Bay because of all of his contributions, working on the bay for over 80 years and being an advocate for the conservation and the preservation of the Chesapeake Bay. And for that, we say thank you, Governor. We hope this story inspires you to preserve and conserve the Chesapeake Bay. We hope this story inspires you to celebrate not only the natural diversity on the Chesapeake Bay, but the cultural diversity on the bay. Whether you live in urban centers like Baltimore, Washington, Philadelphia, anywhere in the Chesapeake Bay watershed and may not come into direct contact, there are things you can do as well. Looking at trash in the storm drains, looking at stormwater runoff, experiencing the environment at your level, wherever you are, to protect this great resource, and so future generations can benefit and learn. And so we hope, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, that you really understand the life and times of Captain Eldridge Meredith, a quintessential Chesapeake Bay waterman. We encourage you to tell your family stories, your legacies, document them, pass them on to future generations so we all can learn the value and the respect that we have for each other. Thank you.
move.
I've worked with a lot of filmmakers throughout the region, but he's a graduate from Annapolis Senior High School. He went on to Morgan State University and got a degree in screenwriting.
It's been an animation, right?
Well, tell the people what you did.
It's such an honor to work with Captain Meredith. People can say to work with like a legendary black waterman of the Chesapeake Bay, you know? I mean, just gonna give him a hug, you know? That's all I can say.
Thanks. Plus, you look good. Thank you. At this time, we're going to have our Lieutenant Governor, Boyd Rutherford, to come up. And the Honorable Jeannie Hathaway Riccio, our former delegate. So whatever one want to go first, that's why I just deferred to you to
all right.
say and
well,
do
thank
what you.
You
want to say and do.
Well, thank you, and happy birthday, Captain.
Thank you.
Soon to be Admiral. Good evening, everyone. I am truly honored to be here for this occasion and opportunity to meet Captain Meredith, and very pleased to participate in this celebration to honor the 101st Admiral of the Chesapeake, Captain Eldridge Meredith. Being named Admiral of the Chesapeake represents the highest honor of maritime environmentalism and advocacy that the governor can award here in Maryland. Since being instituted by Governor Miller Taws in 1959, it has been awarded to individuals who've demonstrated an extraordinary commitment to conservation and restoration of our most important natural asset, that being the Chesapeake Bay. Past recipients have included sailors, journalists, conservationists, elected officials, and others. And today we're pleased to recognize the third generation Queen Anne's County waterman, charter boat captain, restaurateur, U.S. Navy veteran, Captain Meredith, as he takes his place among this long list of prominent individuals. Captain Meredith truly could not be more deserving of this distinguished award. Here is something that's remarkable, but you've heard this already, that the captain has been working the Chesapeake Bay for 80 years. I mean, that shows, I guess, that good hard work keeps you going. I saw Captain Butler out here, who's been with them most of that time, and I think my few little years of almost 60 is something, but it shows that we have to keep working hard every day, right? Isn't that what it's all about? So being named Admiral of the Chesapeake is representative of a lifetime of achievement. As Captain Meredith celebrates his 91st birthday today, I think it's safe to say that he is very much qualified for this honor.
Amen.
And I'm sure he'll tell you that, you know, he was committed to the Bay and not necessarily committed to the accolades that he's getting today. But we're pleased to have this opportunity to give him this well-deserved recognition. Today offers a chance for all of us to celebrate a true living legend and a true Maryland icon. Captain Meredith's independent and innovative spirit has guided him to success on and off the water, not below. You want to stay up. Right. But on behalf of all Marylanders, and of course on behalf of Governor Hogan and our entire administration, we thank him and thank you, Captain, for your service to our country and your stewardship of the Bay. And at this time, it's my honor to present Captain Meredith with this official commission as 103rd Admiral of the Chesapeake. Thank you.
You can turn around so the audience can see you, okay. Captain. Come around this way, Captain. You come in the middle. We have Honorable Jeannie on this side.
Okay. And what I'll do is I'll read this. I have a pretty loud voice, so I don't think I need the microphone. The state of Maryland, Admiral of the Chesapeake, Captain Eldridge Meredith, a rank of respect gratefully conveyed to those who have demonstrated by work and by deed an extraordinary commitment to the conservation and restoration of our beloved Chesapeake Bay, its surrounding landscapes, and the life that inhabits them. This certificate is awarded with our official confidence that you will continue to merit our esteem and favor. Signed by Governor Lawrence J. Hogan, Jr., myself, signed this day, your birthday, in 2017.
Thank you. I'll hang on to it. It's not your turn to talk yet, Captain.
Almost
getting there. That's right. Hey, you got the touch. Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, I got a couple more things. We're going to have Robert Cadell. Robert Cadell is the Director of Educators Connecting Research to the K-16 classroom. His team have put together a whole educational program on Black life on the Chesapeake Bay and the contributions and some of his latest work. He goes for Smithsonian all in Panama and around the country. So he just wanted to show you a little bit about what his team has done to tell your story around the world.
Okay. Pleased to meet you. Okay, so the way this goes is I get phone calls from people like Vince Leggett. And what I represent and who I am speaking for are teachers in three states and for the Smithsonian in terms of developing programs, as well as the country of Panama. And what we do is we wait for a phone call and we hear about, people who have made a difference. And when that happens, we turn you into education. And so I would like to go ahead and show you something. I don't know what you're going to think of this, but it's a little different. When we work with organizations such as Black in the Chesapeake, they alert us to people who are deserving to really be known by young people. And it's very, very important that your legacy is known in ways that are exciting for kids. So believe it or not, for the last month, I've been kind of reading up on you, and I've been developing an education package that includes teaching the history of oystering using paper clips, believe it or not. We use paper clips, as well as we have even done a program at the Smithsonian called Chesapeake Celebrations. And Chesapeake Celebrations included a half-built skipjack miniature that was three floors down that were kids participated in. And we have proceeded to really begin to put together a package that, and I'm here to ask your permission, I would like to make you world famous. I thought you might like to give a speech though.
Hello. It's great to see you all here to celebrate me. With me. I hope you don't mind my speaking out about what is important. It is the Chesapeake Bay. Don't you love the Chesapeake Bay? I love the Chesapeake Bay. Well, thank you for coming to celebrate with me my life of living and working on the Chesapeake Bay. What is exciting is that today, thanks to the nonprofits, the Blacks of the Chesapeake Foundation, as well as the organization Our Creeks and Conservancy, and their educational partner, Motivation Education, I am the link to the past and a bridge to the future. My animated self is happy to be sharing my many contributions and recognitions to young people as an important part of a K-16 legacy project that will become a model for special waterways all over the world. In my time, I have volunteered visiting schools, libraries, historical societies, and museums to tell my life story of being on the water for more than 80 years. Imagine that, more than 80 years. Beyond imagination now, you are seeing in today's modern world how I can become a digital star and urge young people to learn about the bay, take care of the bay, and even learn how they can work on and around the bay to provide the kind of services that people need, just as I did years ago. And throughout my many years of challenges called working the water, I am changing and adapting to the times to do what we all need to do. Love the Chesapeake Bay and all it is to the people of the region. Thank you.
So, with your permission, I will continue to work with teachers because we've been piloting different programs and different ideas based on your life, and we will give you a complete package so that you can have that for your great-grandchildren, and it will be there forever. I work with teachers in Louisiana, and they are very excited to learn your legacy because they want to model a legacy from their region after you. Thank you.
Thank you. Don't leave yet, Captain. And so at this point, we're going to have Mrs. Somerville and tone it down for me, Bob, and some Bob can come up. We did get plaques and certificates from the President of the Senate, the Speaker of the House. The House of Delegates holistically declares you an ambassador of the Chesapeake because the Governor and Lieutenant Governor, only one that can be an Admiral of the Chesapeake. So not only are you an Admiral of the Chesapeake, but I have another citation signed by all members of the House of Delegates and the Speaker that have declared you an Admiral, an ambassador of the Chesapeake. And then we also got information from a Senate resolution from Addie Eckert as well as Steve Hershey. These are two Eastern Shore senators. So they're weighing in. It's all good. Then we're going to hear from Karen, and then we hear from Vera that's going to acknowledge the family. Karen Somerville and Sambakin.
Down to Jordan Street. God's gonna trouble
work on the back of the program. Come on up here, Waterman's daughter.
All right. First, we'd like to thank God for having our father here for 91 years. And in paying tribute to our father, we'd like to take a moment to remember our mother, Miss Margaret. She was a wonderful wife, a business owner, a mother of six successful children, a grandmother and great-grandmother. She was a remarkable woman who lovingly dedicated her life to her husband and her family until her death in 2011. We will never forget her love and dedication.
Amen.
When describing our father, I asked my brothers and sisters for help. My sister Sheila came up with three words: ambitious, fearless, and generous. He is ambitious for getting up 7 days a week, walking across the road in his white hat, his white shirt, and his little black shiny shoes to work on the Island Queen. He's the hardest working man we have ever seen. He's fearless for being strong-willed. He's never afraid of anyone or anything. I remember being on the boat with him when we had a fire. After we put the fire out, I suggested he go to the doctor to get his burns checked. He finally went, had to go to the burn center, but being the fearless man that he is and as strong-willed as he is, he was back on the boat, repaired and filled with customers in 2 days, as if nothing happened. I'll never forget the day we were out on the boat. Suddenly, the fish stopped biting. A huge wave came up from nowhere. Then we felt something beating up under the boat. The customers panicked. My dad calmed them down. Later, we learned that it was an earthquake. Yes, we were out on the Island Queen in an earthquake. We've never lost anyone at sea. We've had a couple of people that have had their last fishing trip with us and pass away on the boat, but never an accident. Many times my brother Tyrone has suggested he stay at home, saying, "Pop, you only have a couple of people. Why not stay home and rest today?" Needless to say, he would go out anyway. We've had good times and bad times on the water. If the boat breaks down, he stays until it's repaired, never giving up. The last word to describe our father is generous. For always showing kindness to his family and others, he has a heart of gold. At the end of the day, when the coolers are full and it's time to go in, we listen to hear his final words of the day. "Catch one for the road. Wind them in. We're on our way. Save some fish for another day. We love you, Pop. May God bless you, and may you continue to do what you love to do."
Thank you, Vera. And we had two fine ladies sitting here at the head table. One is Miss Margie Meredith. Would you stand, please? Please stand. Maggie. Maggie Meredith, Captain Meredith's wife. Can you turn around and wave up for us? Thank you. And the other is my first lady, Sister Aldina Leggett. Please give her a hand. She's the brains of the operation. Thank you both. And so now we're going to have Reverend Johnny, you be on standby. Now we're going to hear from the captain. Captain, come on around. And then Reverend Calhoun is going to benedict us out, and we're going to have our reception. Come closer to the mic. Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Yes, this is your turn.
Well, I want to thank everybody that's coming here tonight. And it's one remark I'd like to leave with everyone. It's taken from the book of Mark, the 12th chapter of Mark. It reads, it says that
everyone that know God, trust in God, he's going to make things straight for him to live. And I found that out years ago. And I know that the chapter, Mark, the 12th chapter, he was during Jesus Christ's time on the earth. He was speaking to the people. And one of the Sadducees said, Teacher, will you tell us what is the main scripture, the main commandment that is in the Bible? So he said, so Jesus said, well, the first one is you want to love Jehovah God with your whole heart, your whole soul, and your whole mind. He said, the second one, you want to love thy neighbor as you love yourself. So them the two greatest ones in the Bible. So I'm leaving the same thing with you all tonight, and I really appreciate everyone that had participated in what we had tonight, and I thank everyone for being out tonight. So I really was surprised, and I know I was surprised when I heard that the governor was coming down, and this one was coming, this one was coming. I said, oh, it can't be. This can't be true. So someone said, oh, yeah, they're coming. So I said, well, I better get ready for them. So anyway, it was on the boat a couple of years ago, and this gentleman goes fish for me a lot. He'd come down about once every 2 weeks. So he'd say, Captain Meredith, come on, help me get on this boat. I had a little step boat like that. I said, sure. So he said, when you get my age, see, you're going to see a big difference. That's what he told me. I said, how old, man, are you? He said, I'm 65. I said, well, I'll tell you. I'm not going to tell you my age. If you say you're 65, leave it like that. I'm not going to tell you my. But I always had plenty of fun on the boat, meeting different people. And I really enjoyed it. And I guess I worked hard. And no one can say that a work will hurt you, because you won't. You keep moving, keep going, that's a help. That's a big help. You sit down and don't do anything. I had some people that worked out in Sparrows Point years ago, used to fish with me. After retired, after 6 months, they're gone. Yeah, they're gone. So I want to thank everybody for coming tonight, and I really was surprised to see everyone. Thank you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Take me to the water. Take me to the water. Somebody help me say, take me to the water. Let's all stand. To be baptized. Let's give God a big hand clap for the Admiral. Thank you for your witness. Thank you for your service. Honor the Lieutenant Governor and all the dignitaries who are here today, all according to protocol, and all those I don't know who to call. We want to thank God for Vince Leggett. Let's give Vince a big hand. Thank you, man. And thank y'all so much. Come on, give him a big hand clap. The way they've been honoring the Blacks in the Chesapeake. We thank you so much. A benediction is a closing blessing. It's imparted by people who are blessed. Anybody blessed in here today? Okay, so listen. I want you to take your blessed self and put your hand gently on somebody's shoulder. Come on, look them in the face. Tell them, I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
I've been blessed.
I've been blessed.
So I'm blessing you.
I'm blessing you.
So go somewhere and be a blessing. God bless you and have a smile upon you.
Let everybody say amen. Everybody say
amen.
Everybody say
amen.
Should I bless the food?
Yes, please.
Are y'all ready to bless the food? Lord, we thank you for the food we're about to receive. Lord, keep it hot. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a smile upon you.
And we're going to do happy birthday. Can you lose the happy birthday?
You ready?
Yes.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
May the good Lord.
May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord
bless you.
May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Everybody say
amen.
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 Amen.